Today, I'm with Mojca Henigman, and we're going to talk about purpose and alignment to our day-to-day life, as well as courage. Mojca, great to have you here.
Hi, George. Great to be here with you, as always.
Yeah, thanks for doing this. So, Mojca, I'm going to read your bio for the audience and so that they have a sense of who you are, and then we're going to get into this as fun conversation. So, let's see. Mojca is a life coach with a creative soul, passionate about helping people live a more conscious, courageous, and empowered life. She is a qualified neuro-linguistic practitioner, NLP practitioner, as well as a voice dialogue facilitator, and she has a master's degree in communication. She works with purpose-driven women to unpeel the layers of self-sabotage and create more fulfillment in their work and in their relationships, and most of all, with themselves. And I'll put the links to Mojca's website, and she also has a Facebook page where she puts some great content, as well as her Instagram as well. I'll put those links in the notes of the video, so be sure to check that out. Mojca is also a member of my MasterHeart Group Coaching Program. It's always great to have her on the various sessions, and her presence is great there. So Mojca, thanks so much for doing this conversation. And so I know there's a lot we can talk about, because you work with clients on some really big stuff, and of course in practical ways in their life. But let's start with the biggest topic. Let's talk about life purpose. What does that mean for you, or how do we clarify our purpose?
Yes. So first of all, thanks for this lovely introduction, George. It's always a pleasure to interact with you as well. And of course, honored to be talking to your audience in this way as well. So yes, purpose is a big word, isn't it? It seems to be more spoken about as well lately. And I think as people just realize that it's meaning for life is not just kind of a fancy, lofty dream, but it's actually possible. And when we have, you know, a sense of meaning in our lives, it just, life seems worth living. It's like there's this sense of purpose is something that really drives you internally. It's like an internal kind of force, if you will, or a calling even, that moves you forward and, you know, gets you to do what you do in with a sense that you want to bring to it. So to make it more specific, it's not, for me, life purpose is not just what we do, even though it's often understood as our calling, isn't it? Our purpose in life is often understood as our calling, but I see it, and I work with my clients on that as well. Purpose being also the person you are being. So your life purpose is being the kind of person you know you can be, sort of the best version of yourself, if you will, and not in the perfectionistic sense, but just showing up as your best self, you know, as much of the time as you can.
Give me one second here. Sorry about that interruption. So you were saying that purpose is not just about our calling, but it's also really about being who we are. So say more about that. What does that mean?
Yes, it's more connecting with what drives you internally. So it's clarifying your deep desires. What do you really want to experience in your life? And not just experiences as in going places, but really... you know, what states do you want to experience? How do you want to be feeling on a daily basis? Then thinking about your values, right, that are really dear to you, and seeing, you know, where are those values in my life now? Because the more aligned we are with our values, the more on purpose we tend to feel in our lives. So that's one piece of it. Then it's also looking at, because we come into this world unique as we are. We all have our unique strengths. Of course, we nurture them and develop them as we go through life. So looking at strengths is really powerful as well, to get the idea of you know, the kind of person that you are, and then being able to connect to that person more consciously. So I mentioned values, desires, strengths, and then another piece that I sort of put under one's purpose is the impact that you want to make, because the impact that you want to see in the world is, I see, sort of part of the purpose in terms of that action, right? That I said, it's not just that, but it's also that. So it also shapes us. The impact we want to have in the world shapes us as people, the way we want to show up in the world, right? How do we want to contribute to the world, if you will? So yeah, those four elements I find are quite a good place to start to clarify your purpose. And then when you're conscious of those, you can be more attentive to bringing them into your everyday more, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's very helpful. Yeah, I actually haven't heard of this definition before, and I think it's really helpful. So you're saying our desires are a natural sense of, you know, kind of points us a little bit toward our purpose, our values, what we really think is important in the world, right? Would you say what those, right? And then our strengths, like what are we able to contribute to the world maybe more than most people are? And then you said the last one was impact, like to actually see what kind of impact we want to make and whether we're making impact. That's really nice. So you work with clients on kind of clarifying these things so that they can see the bigger picture of their purpose. Is that right?
Exactly. To see that, you put it really well, to see the bigger picture. That's the point. Yes. Yeah. And then when you see the bigger picture, then you can translate that into the details.
Yeah, that's of great. Yeah, that sounds like a really, it sounds like it's fun work, and it's really important for people to clarify that for themselves. And working with a coach is really helpful, because a lot of times we get stuck in our own, whether it's our own journaling or our own thinking about it, we get kind of stuck and myopic because we're just in our own head. But when you have someone to bounce ideas with, who's talked with many other people about this kind of stuff, it's helpful to kind of get a better perspective. So That's the perfect kind of work for a coach. Yeah,
it's true. Sometimes it's hard to see your own kind of bigger picture, or even, you know, to know which questions to ask, which you haven't asked yourself yet. Like, we think, okay, we covered all the corners. What else do I ask myself? And that's where the coach comes in so handy, because we're unbiased kind of external person, but interested, you know, invested in client success. So we can help them see a different picture than they've seen so far by asking those skillful questions. That's how I see it.
Is there an example you can think of, whether it's a client you've worked with or in your own life, where you saw that the clarifying of these things helped the person?
Well, it definitely, I can see it in my own life, how I went from my corporate career into coaching, and sort of I've known about coaching before, and I just haven't seen myself in this role. And then when I became more aware of what I really need in my life, or what I'm really good at, and for example, connecting with people, and, you know, not so much being in the back scenes all the time working on my own. So I need this contact with people, for example, and that was, you know, one of the awarenesses. And then all of a sudden it just clicked, and I realized, wow, this is, you know, I really found myself in that. And it also helps me do the impact, or have the impact in the world that I want to have. And it plays to my strengths, and, you know, I can live out my values in this way, which is that contribution, helping others, and also being creative, and, you know, have fun. Fun is one of my big values as well. So definitely my own example is I can think of straight away, but also clients, that I had. And to that note, I'd say that sometimes clients are almost afraid of pursuing their purpose, because it seems so out there. It seems so, you know, like a dream that's impossible to actually bring to life. And that's where I come in as well as a coach, to help them see in what ways they could start bringing that in, right? It doesn't have to be in one fell swoop, but perhaps just starting to follow those breadcrumbs, as, you know, as we say, to get on track with the purpose. And that's why I also said the courage is so important, because it is a courageous action to start following that purpose that you feel is true to you, but maybe it goes against what, you know, people, even important people in your life, might be expecting of you. I don't know that if that answers
yes,
the question.
Yes, it definitely. Yeah, I think that's part of why working with a coach is helpful, because we ourselves, when we're thinking about these larger questions, can feel pressured by the people around us to stay with one particular path. and whether it's family or friends who have only known us, for example, to work in the corporate, or have only known us to be one playing one particular role. So somebody who can like see your best without the bias of friends and family, I think it's really helpful. So
Exactly. Let's
move into talking about aligning and kind of bringing this big question of purpose down into more everyday life. Mm-hmm. How does that alignment happen?
Yeah, so alignment is about, first is awareness, right? Of those elements and of your purpose and who you want to be in the world, which then guides your actions. And aligning with that on day to day, really. It comes down to that. I mean, also in terms of your goals, right? There can be short-term, medium-term, or long-term goals. But I think the real work really happens day to day. And it's being intentional. Right, keeping that purpose in mind, being connected to that purpose, and then setting yourself an intention, let's say for a day or a week or however you want to do that, but then bring yourself back to that intention. You know, it can be almost like an anchor for you, and it's almost like approaching life in a slightly different way. Even if you can't change your life, you know, completely to, I know what my purpose would be. I would want to be this way, you know, tomorrow. You can start small, right? So you can start somewhere. You can, even in the actions, for example, if you can't change, let's say, your career, I do work with people a lot on their career and to get more sense of purpose in what they do. So even if they can't change their role straight away, perhaps, but how can they bring more of that, you know, more of themselves in that way? For example, if they feel they would really want to be creative, how can you bring creativity to your day now, right? Can you carve out some time, or can you even bring it to your existing role? So it's about finding those places where your purpose can already be alive in your life now, you know, where you can be that person already. So one is intention, and this just mindfulness, I guess, right? Being mindful of that purpose and where you can bring it in. And that, can translate into very specific actions. Like I said, maybe you carve out time for those activities, or think through how you could be, you know, more the way you want to be in your activities that you've been doing so far. And then also an important one is to bring yourself into that, kind of, I guess, the way you want to be more of in the world. I'm not sure if I'm making myself clear, but what I'm getting at is managing your state day to day, right? If you intend to be a certain person, let's say you want to feel more joyful, right? And you, George, are the best example for that with your joyful productivity class, which I loved so much, is how can I bring joy to my work, right? If that is one of your values, if that is, you know, if your purpose is to be a joyful, you know, kind of person. And it's not that simplistic, I guess. It's not just one thing. Usually it's the purpose is a bit more, how would I say?
Like multifaceted. There's
exactly. It's like a 3D. It's more 3D. Yes. Yeah. But for example, just managing your state in terms of those specific elements, I guess, that fall into that as well.
Say more about what it means to manage your state. I think you and I, we think in these terms because we think about productivity and things. But for the person who, you know, hasn't really been mindful of that, what does it mean to manage our state? Mm-hmm.
Yes. So state, very simply, state is in our internal state, right? And you can translate it as into feelings, right? In NLP terminology, we call them states, but it is the way you feel in any moment. And the state changes throughout the day. Just imagine you see a picture of someone you love, right? You probably have kind of a warm feeling, unless you just had an argument with them, right? Then you might be a bit a bit upset. But generally, right, you see a pet that you really love, right, your cat or your dog, and you just feel, you know, loving. That's a state. For example, I don't know, you receive a letter, or you receive a bank statement, and you're like, oh my God, I'm worried about, you know, what's going to be in there or something. Or you receive bills, and maybe you're not financially well off, and you'll be anxious, right? That's a state. Stressed is a state. Frustrated, overwhelmed, all those states, right? But then also joyful is a state. focused is a state. Those are all states. They basically combine, our thoughts, our thought processes, and also our physiological kind of sensations in our body, right? That comprises a state. And when I say manage our state, it means literally being more in control of that, being aware that actually we don't just, fall in and out of states haphazardly. Something happens, right? So there is an element of trigger. And if we can be triggered by something external, like a photo or a letter or a phone call, it means we can also trigger it ourselves. And that's very empowering, because when you know that you can actually manage your state, right? So be more in charge of your state, you can bring yourself into that state when you need it. And I find that really, really useful, just really useful on a daily basis, and very empowering wider sense, just knowing that you can have more control of your state. Absolutely. Moment to moment.
That's very helpful. So, and finally, let's talk about courage. What does it mean how can we live with more courage? Why is that important? And how can we live with more courage?
Yeah, so courage is literally, it's one of my favorite qualities. And I see it so important to be able to live true to yourself. Because just like I said before, right, there's different expectations. It can be by specific people or even just cultural kind of, expectations to live a certain way, to be a certain way. And that doesn't always, that's not always fulfilling, right? And it's not really conducive to a happy, kind of joyful, purposeful life. So I see courage as really, people often look, almost everyone wants more confidence, but I see confidence as something that you build when you go and do that thing that scared you. But courage is almost like a step before. So in order to start doing that, you need courage to even start, right? So I see it as such a almost like that first step to do something that scares you, but you also know it's important for you, right? And it's that necessary quality to bring to be able to get outside your comfort zone. And I really believe that growth and progress and a happy life lives out just outside our comfort zone. And to be able to get out there, we need courage. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, courage, because our goals, our dreams, our values, living those often causes we're intimidated or we're fearful of a failure, of rejection, of disappointing ourselves, etc. So, I know we could talk about this for hours, but what's one thing we can, how we can think about living with more courage on a day-to-day basis?
Yeah. So it, for me and in my work, it always comes to first to awareness, being aware what actually scares you. Cause sometimes we live in our lives without even realizing. We think we're doing things that we want to do, but or we find ourselves not doing something or procrastinating, not really being aware that there's some fear involved. And if we address that fear head on, maybe have a dialogue with it, maybe journal on it, maybe talk to someone about it, we could find a way through and thereby build our courage. But by not being aware, it's almost, that's what they call self-sabotage. It's like we're working against ourselves by not going into those places that, scare us and sort of block us in a way. And so I also think it takes courage in the first place to even go and look at those places, because it can be much more comfortable to sweep things under rug, issues in relationships, in your career. You feel a little bit of niggle of, discomfort, or you feel unhappy and like, oh, it's going to pass. And, I think it takes courage to look at those things in the first place. And then when you do that, then, it takes more courage to actually take a step forward in the right direction that will be more fulfilling to you and more purposeful for you. Yeah. But
And I think sometimes we can borrow the courage of a coach.
Absolutely.
By ourselves, it is easy to stay in the current situation. I mean, it's because if we don't do anything by default, we will continue on the same patterns we've been living. And it's like when you work with a coach or you have a friend who is willing to challenge you, it's like, okay, yes, I'm willing to become aware of what's really going on and then start to take steps to step into that courage. And sort of, do you have any, well, encouragement, I guess, for us? Because it is, well, by default, living with courage is scary.
Yeah, I know it is. And just one thing that you mentioned, yeah, leaning on the support that you have around you. I mean, being an entrepreneur, I've been very self-reliant all my life, and becoming an entrepreneur, I started to realize how important community is and support systems around you, and really having people you can rely on. And of course, you know, you offer the same in return. It's a two-way street. But yeah, one is definitely support system. And the second can be, yeah, a coach, because the coach is someone that will believe almost in you on your behalf, right? Even when you don't believe in yourself, the coach will be there to hold that space and believe in you. And sometimes that's what we need to be able to move forward with courage. And third, I would say is, yeah, just remember that you have so much more, so many more resources, so much more going for you that you're aware of. I mean, I think we all do. It's just those, you know, inner critics and those sabotaging voices inside trying to keep us small. They are basically trying to keep us, just like you said, in the comfort zone, right? Trying to preserve the status quo. Just reminding ourselves that status quo, I mean, staying in the comfort zone isn't really status quo, because the comfort zone will start to become more and more uncomfortable if you don't attempt to stretch it periodically. So reminding yourself that actually, if you really want to live a fulfilling life, then I think courage is really necessary. So I don't know if that helps, but
absolutely, it does help. So how can people work with you if they're listening to this, watching this, and they want to have you as their coach to live with more purpose, to clarify their purpose, align it to their life, and then to live with courage? How do you work with people?
So I work one-on-one with people. That's the main way I do my work. And I have packages ranging from 3 months, you know, and up. People can find me on Facebook and get in touch, or get in touch on my website, which I believe you're going to post in the comments.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I just want to encourage people. Mojca is very approachable and kind and wise. So please feel free just to reach out to her if you have any comments or questions about what we discussed today. And Mojca, you also have an upcoming online workshop experience that I want to make sure people know about.
Yes, and it actually does tie in with what we spoke about. It's about learning how to manage your state and to align it more with your goals, so you actually help yourself achieve those goals in a more, I guess, pleasant and easeful way, rather than, you know, so you get there in one piece, I will say. it's basically, it's going to be around learning how to manage your state, identifying which states you need, right, specifically, and then giving you the tools so you can implement that in your life and reap the results.
Yes. And so I'll put the information in the notes of the video, and we don't even have to say what the date is, because people may be watching this different times, and we'll have, people can buy it as a recording, and you will have another upcoming workshop, I'm sure, whenever people watch this. So thank you, Mojca, for the work that you do and for sharing in this conversation.
Thank you, George. It's been a pleasure. Thank you so much.